Hey everyone, Servin here, and today we're going to continue with our discussion on preferment. So after we've made our case for preferment, I think it's only fitting that we shift our attention to how to use it and when to use it. We're going to start with a yeasted preferment. Out of the many kinds of yeasted preferment, Poolish and Poolish only will be discussed here. Personally, I resort to Bega when I have a hydration issue with the dough. Other than that, I do prefer Poolish. Pat fermente, also called fermented dough, old dough, is another kind of preferment more relevant to lean doughs and often used in France for traditional baguettes. Biga and pat fermente are essentially based on more or less the same principles as Poolish. Considering the sheer amount of information that we're going to touch on here, I don't think we need to elaborate on these two preferments. Therefore, we're not going to discuss them in this video. Also, I have to inform you that this is not a tutorial on how to make preferments. A preferment such as Poolish is super easy to make, usually takes less than 1 minute. You can see how it is done in the many recipe videos I've made. Okay, so how do we use Poolish? If you remember our discussion in my previous video on preferment, the two main objectives of making a yeasted preferment are first and foremost to create flavor compounds, and second, to scale up the amount of yeast that we're going to use. We're going to talk about flavor compounds in a moment, but for the time being, let's focus on the yeast. Say we want to convert a straight dough recipe that calls for a total of 250 grams of flour and 1% of instant yeast, baker's percentage, so 2.5 grams. Using a Poolish instead of 2.5 grams, we would need to use just a fraction of that amount. To explain how that's possible, we need to know that unlike flour and other ingredients, baker's yeast can and will multiply and grow during fermentation as long as there is a sufficient amount of nutrients coming from the combination of flour and water. As a matter of fact, we learned from this paper that given sufficient nutrients, the yeast cells double in number every 100 minutes or so. Knowing this simple principle of yeast propagation, we can prepare the nutrients that the yeast needs and start making the Poolish. We usually use a portion of the total flour. For example, out of 250 grams of the total flour, we may use 20% of it, 50 grams. This amount of flour will be mixed with the same amount of water, 50 grams, and to that mixture we'll add the same percentage of yeast as in the original straight dough recipe, 1% of the flour weight or 0.5 grams. Okay, now under ideal temperatures for yeast fermentation, 27 to 32 degrees Celsius, it will only take a few hours for this Poolish that we've just made to mature. And by mature, I mean that the Poolish reaches its peak. This is when the yeast is practically done with consuming most of the available nutrients. The Poolish has domed slightly and has just begun to recede on the surface, and some areas can be seen as a bit more concave. At 27 degrees Celsius, it takes around 3 to 4 hours for this to happen. To simplify things, let's just assume that it takes about 3.5 hours. At this mature stage, we can estimate the projected amount of yeast based on this simple calculation. With a fermentation time of 210 minutes, if it takes the yeast about 100 minutes to double their cell counts, then we can expect at least 2 cycles of yeast growth. And since each cycle doubles the yeast cell counts, based on this simple calculation, we should expect an equivalent of at least 2 grams of instant yeast. Now, this minimal projection of 2 grams of instant yeast is not exactly the 2.5 grams that we need for the original straight dough recipe. But we have to take into consideration that our estimation is based on the lower end of the calculation. Of course, to get a number that is closer to 2.5 grams, we can raise the amount of all the ingredients of the Poolish, but I usually keep it at this level or sometimes just simply raise the concentration of the yeast, like from 0.5 grams to 0.6 grams. This is because the actual final amount of yeast could be more than the minimum amount we estimated. So that's how we scale up the yeast. Of course, when it comes to preferment, scaling up the yeast is not the only thing to observe. There's also another, perhaps more crucial aspect behind why we use Poolish, that is, to develop flavor. To that end, we can adjust the amount of yeast with or without adjusting the amount of the flour and the water. Also, to develop flavor, we do not let the Poolish ferment at room temperature. After the mixing is done, we cover it, and often, but not always, with the purpose of adding more complex flavor, we let it ferment for about 1 to 2 hours on the counter at room temperature, 27 to 29 degrees Celsius. And then we leave it in the fridge to cold ferment at 5 to 10 degrees Celsius, usually overnight. Once it ripens, which we can tell by the height of the rise through our previous experiments at room temperature, the poolish will then be incorporated into the final dough, mixed with the rest of the ingredients, and after that, the final dough will go through kneading, bulk fermentation, shaping, and proofing, all done at room temperature before we move on to baking it in the oven. For yeasted preferments in our previous video, we explained the benefits of this approach using these two papers, one published in 2012, the other in 2016. I'm going to repeat some of what we discussed here. From the first study, we learned that increasing the pressed baker's yeast concentration from 2% to 6% caused an increased formation of the majority of aroma compounds formed from the fermentative activity of yeast. On the other hand, decreasing the fermentation temperature to 5 degrees Celsius was found to increase formation of the three esters, ethyl acetate, ethyl hexanoate, and ethyl octanoate in bread, which are often characterized as having a fruity and pleasant aroma. From the results, it is therefore suggested to ferment the dough at a low temperature, 5 degrees Celsius, with a simultaneous increase in the concentration of pressed yeast to 6% in order to develop the bread with a relatively short production time combined with a high concentration of esters and a low concentration of hexanol and heptanol, which are often characterized as having a respectively green and fatty or rancid odor. For our practical purposes, going along with this recommendation means we can adjust the concentration of our preferment that uses instant yeast up to as high as 2%, because 6% pressed yeast is about 2% instant yeast. Of course, as a consequence of the adjustment, the fermentation time will be shorter. So going back to our previous example, when we said we would raise the yeast from 0.5 to 0.6, and at the same time do not raise the amount of flour and water, we're talking about a raise of the yeast concentration from 1% to 1.2%, a small difference of 0.2%. So for all the conveniences of a good rest at night, we can leave our preferment in the fridge and bring it out the next morning to be used in the final dough. Of course, this is not a set procedure. For the sake of the bread aroma, as the paper suggested, we can raise the concentration of yeast to 2% and cold ferment it for a shorter duration. So whether we choose a long cold fermentation with low concentrations of instant yeast or a quick cold fermentation with higher concentrations of instant yeast, that falls into the art of bread making, not the science of bread making. Anyway, both approaches for sure will bring us a considerable amount of aroma compounds. Now, once our Poolish has its rest in the fridge and is at its peak, it is ready for use. When it comes to incorporating a Poolish into our final dough, a Poolish is essentially a flavorful leavening agent. A question that I often get asked is, do we need to cold ferment the final dough, say placing the final dough in the fridge to let it slowly ferment? From this paper, we can infer that cold fermentation is unnecessary for the final dough with Poolish, and it might actually be counterproductive. To explain, while this paper found compatible results with the previous paper, that is, bread samples fermented at 8 and 16 degrees Celsius resulted in increased amount of the three esters. In this paper, though, the researchers discovered that for the bread crust, a higher amount of yeast fermented at 32 degrees Celsius gave better results. A more recent paper published in 2023, this one, has also confirmed these results for yeast fermentation. From this paper, we learned that in yeast bread dough, long cold fermentation and short fermentation at higher temperatures will end up with similar amounts of maltose, regardless of the duration of fermentation. From the paper, this effect is probably due to the subsequent phenomena of starch hydrolysis leading to an accumulation of maltose and its further hydrolysis by the yeast maltase into glucose. The balance between these two mechanisms occurring simultaneously results in similar amounts of maltose regardless the duration of fermentation. Because glucose is the preferred substrate of yeast, long fermentation will end up with less glucose, and once the yeast runs out of glucose to eat, it will go for fructose. These reducing sugars, glucose and fructose and amino acids, play very important roles in the Maillard reaction during baking. Consequently, they have great impacts on the sensory and nutritional characteristics of the breads. less glucose and fructose translate to less Maillard reactions. So in conclusion for yeasted fermentation, my understanding of all this is that a preferment, adjustable as it is, can bring us all the flavors that we want in a bread and at the same time deliver the essential and active leavening agent at its prime. While variations could be made to get the desired flavor in the bread, but essentially a final dough that is made with a yeast preferment that has gone through long cold fermentation has no real need for further flavor development using cold fermentation. It is already done in the preferment, and actually, if we need more flavor, we can simply adjust the amount of preferment used, or as explained before, adjust the essential parameters of the preferment, such as the yeast concentration and the duration of fermentation. Therefore, a final dough with a yeasted preferment can get better results for the flavor of the bread crust by fermenting at room temperature, or at the ideal temperature as shown in these two papers. That's why once our Poolish is ready, we incorporate it into the final dough and then continue with the normal steps of dough processing at room temperature. That is, going through mixing, kneading, bulk fermentation, shaping, proofing, and eventually baking in the oven. For years, we've been using yeasted preferments this way. They are reliable and have been continuously used in making great breads for us. From this paper, we've learned that up to 50% of the total flour can be used for yeasted preferments, such as Poolish. The method used in the paper is pretty much like what we do here, and I quote, "The leaven is fermented for 2 hours under optimum conditions, i.e. at 28 degrees Celsius, then the temperature is lowered to 10 degrees Celsius, and the leaven is stored till the next day for the purpose of making the dough, its proofing and baking." The leaven, as mentioned in this paper, was made with 80% hydration and 110% hydration, which in the paper were respectively called leaven with 180% yield and 210% yield. In this paper, the evaluation of the sensorial properties of the bread was done by a panel of 12 consumers. The results of hedonic tests on different types of bread indicated that the aroma and flavor was the most like in bread produced with preferments that had gone through cold fermentation. So when top of the analytic and quantitative facts that I've explained, there are guidelines as shown in this study. In my previous video, when I explained that long fermentation without preferment is a bad idea, besides the issue of food safety that I raised, I also basically laid out that when it comes to a yeast bread, long fermentation alone cannot bring out all the complex flavors of a bread. In fact, if we look at this paper that we have referenced before, the researchers conducted a descriptive sensory analysis that involved 9 well-trained panelists. From the test, the statistical evaluation showed that the panelists were consistent in their ratings. However, no significant differences were perceived between the samples. Therefore, the paper concluded the difference between long and short fermentation in terms of selected aroma profiles presented in the research did not seem to affect the sensory quality of the bread. These are some of the parameters of the experiment. If I may speculate, one possible explanation for this is that in yeast breads made with short fermentation at a high temperature, the Maillard reaction brings out as many complex flavors as the flavors that the long fermentation dough at low temperatures produces. All of this, of course, is different from those complex flavors that emerge from Poolish breads. Poolish breads have more complex flavors due to the combination of long and short fermentations. We can reasonably argue that these complex flavors are stronger than the flavors that were produced as a result of long fermentation or short fermentation separately. This reasoning is based on the facts that were presented in this study that we've mentioned before, where numerous tests indicated that significant sensory notes were detected. Okay, now let's talk about sourdough preferment, Levain. So I'm going to use this paper again, and I quote, "In sourdough bread, long fermentation promoted the Maillard reaction and aromas from the metabolism of lactic acid bacteria and had a positive effect on the sensory perception of the crust and crumb." Here are some more interesting bits from the paper. Much like yeast bread dough due to starch hydrolysis, the maltose content increased regardless of fermentation duration. While many sourdough lactobacilli are known to be highly adapted to use maltose as a substrate, the study indicated that the maltose content did not decrease after long fermentation. The low temperature, 6 degrees Celsius, during the long fermentation process could partly explain this low consumption of maltose, the authors explained. The glucose content increased slightly after short fermentation and significantly after long fermentation by 1.5 times. The paper went on to suggest that during both processes, the release of glucose by the hydrolysis of maltose and or sucrose is compensated by the consumption by the sourdough microorganisms, explaining the similar levels of glucose. Moreover, glucose seems not to be the main substrate for sourdough lactobacilli, which explains the high levels remaining in the dough after long fermentation. The paper also showed that the fructose content significantly decreased in both the fermented doughs, especially after short fermentation. Sourdough microorganisms seem to prefer fructose over maltose and glucose. Even so, higher fructose content was found in long fermentation, the paper explained. During the long fermentation, the low temperature could slow down the metabolic activity of the lactobacilli and thus their consumption of fructose. Again, these reducing sugars, along with the amino acids that participate in the Maillard reaction during baking, have great impacts on the sensory and nutritional characteristics of the breads. So these facts directly influence how our bread turned out. On the subject of long fermentation, from the paper I quote, "In yeast bread, long fermentation favored the generation of aromas from yeast metabolism in the dough, but limited the formation of aromas from the Maillard reaction in the crust. In sourdough bread, long fermentation promoted the Maillard reaction and aromas from the metabolism of lactic acid bacteria, and had a positive effect on the sensory perception of the crust and crumb." So, in conclusion, a long-fermented sourdough bread made with levain has a better flavor. For sourdough, letting the final dough bulk ferment slowly in the fridge can be beneficial for the bread. Of course, there are many more wonderful things that we can get from a sourdough bread, and hence, there's quite a lot more to talk about, but that's best reserved for other days. For the time being, that's it for today. Thanks for watching, and bye!